I'm Lynn.
And I'm Mark.
And we're glad you joined us today.
Welcome to the Digital Marketing Hotseat Podcast,
where small business owners ask us their number one pain point digital marketing question.
And put us in the hot seat.
Hi, I'm Lynn Smargis, and I'm a content writer specializing in ghostwriting, podcast production, and SEO website content.
And I'm Mark Thackeray, and I specialize in social media marketing, specifically Facebook and Instagram ads, email marketing, and email automation.
I'm ready, Mark. Are you ready?
I sure am. Let's do this.
Hey, small business owners, we are so glad you joined us again for another episode of the Digital Marketing Hot Seat Podcast, where you get to listen to small business owners putting Mark and me in the hot seat to answer their digital marketing questions. So Mark, how's your digital marketing week and what client work has your attention this week?
Well, let's see. So that's a great question. I would say this week in particular, I'm thinking about one of my clients that needs help. They already have existing clients. So they do a lot of work with those clients, but there's a percentage of that audience that could be doing more work with them. And so we are working on an email campaign to help them really broadcast out all their whole suite of offerings of services that they can provide to these clients. And so that they know, and it's funny, as I was talking with this client this morning, she was talking about how powerful this can be. She's had trouble in the past getting these emails out, and just because they take a lot of time. She's like, oh, such a big time suck. But she also knows how important they are. She told me that one of her clients, because of an email, this client responded and said, oh, I didn't know that was something you do. And it led to a six figures over the course of, I don't know, it's eight or I think she said 8 or 9 years, just from this one client, from this one email that found out all the things that she could do. And so, yeah, it's a fun thing. But we're diving deep into that this week. What about you, Lynn? What you tell me? How's your marketing going this week? And what about you? Is there a specific project that you've been focusing on?
Yeah, that's funny that your client has that project, because that's actually the same exact project I'm working on for you. Like literally just getting more, because because it's one of the things a business coach had said to me. They're like, do people really know what you offer as services? And I'm like, not all of them. So that's actually the same thing I'm working on, which I think is a great email marketing campaign. So for me, it's actually a little bit related. Well, it's definitely related to email marketing, but it's lead magnet. So lead magnet, for those of you who don't know, is a piece of information you give somebody in exchange for their email. So it increases your email marketing list. And this week I am working on a client who has a 10-page ebook as a lead magnet. So it talks about like what he does and explains a little bit of background on him. And then obviously when people come to his website, they will download the ebook and then they give him their email. So it's a great way to increase your email marketing, your number of emails for your email marketing campaign.
Yeah. I love those. Yeah. We use those quite a bit too. That's a great way, no risk way to start building that relationship and building that rapport with potential customers. Very cool. Very cool.
Before we get into today's episode, Mark, would you like to tell our listeners about our upcoming Digital Marketing 101 episodes? We have a couple left.
Yes. So our Digital Marketing 101 episodes are basically an overview of the basics of digital marketing. So and our goal is to help you be educated on what digital marketing is, kind of the overall definition of it, the scope, as well as the various components of digital marketing, so that you can decide which one of those you want to really focus in on to increase your exposure online. And so we've covered, website, we've covered SEO, we've talked about social media a little bit. We're going to be diving more into social media today, email marketing, things like that. But we're covering kind of an umbrella of topics, essentially, so that you can get an overview of which one it's going to be, you're more of a natural fit for. And so you can kind of focus on those as you move forward. But they're a lot of fun. Yeah. So let's get into our topic this week, which you already mentioned, Lynn, is unraveling the social media mystery. So why don't you get us started on that?
Absolutely. So one of the things people, the first thing everybody always tells me, which is absolutely true, is like social media is constantly changing. It's like AI on one platform changes, and then you turn around 3 weeks later, the AI on like every other platform has changed. And so for AI, if you don't know what that means, it means artificial intelligence. So that is basically the programming that the social media platforms use that that will like put certain posts up front and other posts like not as prominent in the social media feed. So the ones that are showing up in your feed are a result of the AI that the social media platform will put up there. And there are so many social media platforms. And one of the questions I always get asked is, which one should I be on? So Mark and I today are going to just break it down and talk about five of the major social media platforms. There's like 30 of them out there. Of course, you could be on all of them if you wanted to, but you really want to focus on one or two to interact with. But we're just going to go over the five because I always tell my clients, it depends on what you're doing and what your vertical is, on what platform you really want to be active on. So the first one we're going to talk about is Twitter. And so Twitter is a platform that only limits you to 240 characters. And I believe there's also a time link on videos on Twitter as well. I haven't done much with posting video on Twitter. I've done some, but I know there is the character length, and that includes hashtags and spaces. So your message has to be very concise on Twitter. And so I know one of the fields that is really great for Twitter is if you're in education or in you're in technology. So Mark, what are your takes on Twitter?
You know, Twitter is an interesting one because it is so concise. It does have the character limit, which is good and bad, right? I mean, you can, it depends on how you want to look at it, because I think it's good because it forces you to really think strategically about what you're saying. You know, it's a lot easier to just keep talking. You know, a lot of times we tend to talk ourselves out of a sale sometimes because we're just blah, 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 blah. We just keep going. And so I think if it forces you to become more concise and be more clear in your messaging, then that's a great thing. That is a tremendous thing. Can be very powerful that way. But conversely, it can also limit you. And for those that don't take the time to be strategic about it, it can be very ineffective. You know, I mean, because you don't have the ability to provide the whole context. You know, going back to the kind of sales analogy, you wouldn't pay someone, a salesperson, to go in and say, you know what, Lynn, you only have 280 characters, 300 characters, 500 characters to use during the sales presentation. That's it. That's all you get. You know, you wouldn't say that. You'd say, do whatever you do to need to get whatever you need to do to make the sale, type thing. So I can see it in both ways, but it's useful for those very short, condensed messages. And for that reason, you can skim through a lot of information that way. You know, a lot of news and, you know, you mentioned lead magnets earlier can be effective just because it's that short snippet. And especially, you know, in a world where we're all trying to get attention for ourselves, a lead magnet is a great way to kind of take the focus off of our company and put it more on your audience. And so I think in that sense, Twitter might be pretty effective. But what about you? What about you, Lynn? What do you think about Twitter as we're talking about this social media platform, what comes to mind?
Yeah, one of the things that's most frustrating for me as a writer is what you said, like, I'm so limited to write, but I write. And for me as a writer, it's really frustrating because I'm like, I need to shorten everything. And that is much harder to go from a longer thing to a shorter piece of content than to go from a shorter piece of content to a longer piece of content. So, but I do like it for that fact that you said you can scroll through things really quick. And you can also, like, it's a really great way to network online and get a hold of people who aren't in your geographic area as well. So I like Twitter a lot for that. Talking about networking, LinkedIn is another great social media platform. And the biggest question the biggest statement I should say I always get from my clients for LinkedIn is, I know I should be on LinkedIn, but I don't know what to do. And so we're going to actually do a whole episode just on LinkedIn and how you can utilize and leverage your LinkedIn marketing. But for today, we're just going to talk about basics. So you can create articles on LinkedIn. You want to have a personal profile that's well filled out, because if it's not well filled out, you will not get the attraction that you need on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is definitely it's really great for B2B, so business to business. Mm-hmm. You can also do business to consumer, but there's a lot of business to business going on LinkedIn. So if you are a B2B company, definitely want to be on LinkedIn. You can put articles on there. and you can do regular posts, you can put videos. So it's a really great way to put a lot of different media that explains what you do for your company on LinkedIn, and also to connect with people as well that you like. You want to be strategic about it, like you said before, strategically connect with people on LinkedIn that would be really good cross referrals for you, or really good business partners. And so I am actually ramping up my LinkedIn efforts right now to be doing more marketing on LinkedIn. So Mark, what about you? What's your take on LinkedIn?
Yeah, LinkedIn, again, like you said, Lynn, is a lot of these platforms are going to depend on the audience that you're trying to reach. So if you are B2B, then LinkedIn is a must, really. You know, I mean, you have to, you need to take the time, like you said, to fill out your profile so that you're speaking to your ideal audience. You know, so if you service this particular vertical or industry, make sure that is represented on your profile, you know, and you can add posts, you can add, you know, so if you were to go to mine, for example, it has, because I've done a lot of work in the dental industry, and was exclusively dental for a number of years before we opened it up, but there was a lot of dental content on there. So it had case studies that were specific to, you know, local dentists and the growth that they, you know, experience when working with them. And so it can be a very, very effective platform. If you are B2B, it's really the best platform, social platform, if you are B2B. But I think it's also a great way to build authority, you know, and to build credibility, and position yourself as a thought leader in your industry, you know, because it's being seen by a different audience than Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. It's a little bit more, shall I say, you know, educated, qualified, maybe those two aren't the right words, but it is a different audience there. And so I think you have the opportunity to set yourself apart, and kind of build up your credibility there a little bit more than on some of the other platforms. It's also a good platform for collaboration. So if you reach out, it can be, because it's more, you mentioned it too, Lynn, it's a networking platform. And so as such, there's people that are eager to connect, you know, I mean, that's, you know, Facebook, you add friends and you have a lot of friends on Facebook, but are they really friends, kind of thing? And you can get into that with LinkedIn as well, but there's also, if you're good at it and you're strategic about it, then you can find those people to collaborate with and really make it a win-win scenario where you're gaining access to each other's audience per se. So that's a great one. Instagram, you know, moving on to the next one is completely different. You know, I mean, it's a lot more of a visual platform. You know, it's kind of photos first and then copy second, you know, and so you have to adjust your strategy for that. And so for those that, you know, those businesses that do have certainly a visual component to what they do, and I would argue that almost all companies do. And so you could make the case to be on Instagram as well. But again, for me, a lot of it comes back to, is your audience spending time on Facebook? Is your ideal audience spending time on Instagram? Excuse me. Then if so, then you want to look more closely at those platforms. And you want to be a little bit more selective of what you put out there in the messaging, because you want it to look, if Instagram's more of a show than tell kind of platform. You know, some of the other ones are, you know, Twitter, I would say, and LinkedIn is a little bit less visual. It's a little bit more tell than show. But Instagram, yeah, it's an Instagram too. I would, you know, going back to my comment earlier about collaboration, man, that's a great one. A lot of people are looking, you see that all the time, and oh, DM me for collaboration or collabs, you know, and just, it's kind of built into the system now. So that is another way to do it as well. But what's your, Lynn, let's go back to you. What about you and your experience on Instagram? What would you say about that?
Oh, I love Instagram. Is my favorite platform. One biggest strike against it is it's owned by Facebook. but you know, but I love Instagram. And if you are in anything of travel, leisure, fashion, art, anything that is visual, like you said, Mark, Instagram is, you have to be on Instagram. It's a no brainer. Not that you have to, but like, if you're going to be on one platform, you're going to be on Instagram, because like hairstylists, like anything makeup artist that is visual is like that is all what Instagram is about, is the visual. So the first thing people look at is like the video. And so right now they're promoting reels. And so Reels are 15 second or shorter videos that you can put like music behind, all that good stuff. And they're really fun to look at and they're very addicting. So I try not to do it too much because I'll just sit on my phone forever and scroll through Reels. And there's lots of cute puppy dog Reels and kitty cat and all that good stuff. But the whole point with Instagram is, like you said too, it's really great for messaging people and collaborating as well. And I've done a lot of collaborations on Instagram with big companies that I would not normally be able to get a hold of if I wasn't on Instagram. So it's really great for that. And it's really great because you can do lots of different formats of, so you can do like multiple pictures, you can do one picture, you can do 15 second or less Reels, you can do longer, like more than 15 seconds and put it on a regular like video post. So there's so many different types of options you can do with Instagram. And one, a really big favorite one, well, there's a couple of favorites people do. One is microblogging, which means you're like writing a 100-word blog post basically. And then another one is the live. So you can do live by yourself. You can do live with other people at the same time. It's really cool platform. It gives you lots of options to get the word out there about what you're doing. So if you're doing anything that is visual, you definitely want to be on Instagram.
Do you need more people visiting your website? Are you looking for higher ranking on Google searches? Or are you frustrated by the ever-changing rules of social media?
Mark and I are here to take away the headaches and stress of digital marketing with services such as website content, social media ads, and website SEO. We can provide the digital marketing magic you need to increase the number of people seeing your website and clicking on your business links.
Visit our website at www.digitalmarketinghotseat.com and hit us up on our contact page to reserve your complimentary consult. Find out how our marketing team can take the worry and hassle of digital marketing off of your plate and onto ours.
So the next platform we're talking about, Mark, is Facebook. And so Facebook, we know, has been around for a long time. I remember getting off of, oh my gosh, I can't remember the name of it's the platform nobody's on anymore.
MySpace.
Anyway, what was that?
MySpace?
Yes, MySpace. I remember being on MySpace, my friend being like, hey, there's this new platform called Facebook. I'm like, really? Let me check it out. And I think I joined in like 2004, or so it was like a long time ago. Anywho, Facebook has gotten lots and lots of layers on top of it since then. You have to have a personal account to have your business page. So you can't just have a business page. And then you can also create groups. So there's differences between pages and groups. And Facebook is really great for anybody that wants to have a conversation or anybody that has a avatar that is a demographic of 40 plus or 35 plus, because there's more of an older population on Facebook. And so if your avatar is the older avatar, like that demographic, Facebook is a good place to be. So Mark, what is your, and you are the Facebook ad specialist, what is your take on Facebook?
Oh, Facebook is, it is so powerful. You know, I mean, there's so many people on, it's the largest of the social media. If you exclude, I mean, YouTube is, we'll talk about that in just a second, but it's Facebook has so many active monthly users. It's astonishing, really. I mean, so you do have the most potential you have the potential to reach the most people via Facebook. And I would argue YouTube as well is up in that as, but yeah, Facebook is, from an ad side, you know, we've been talking mostly about growing these platforms organically and doing it on your own, but from an advertising side, Facebook is extremely powerful. It's going to be a lot less expensive than paying, you know, Google for Google ads, pay-per-click. It's going to be less expensive than LinkedIn, can be very expensive on the paid side. And even YouTube, well, it depends on what type of what you're promoting, but Facebook can be very inexpensive, Facebook and Instagram. So it's a great way to reach new audiences that way. But I agree with you, what you said, Lynn, on, you know, from an organic content side, conversations are king on Facebook, you know? And so yes, there's a visual component to that. And yes, they have adopted, you know, they prioritize video, just like Instagram does, and like a lot of these platforms do, because it increases the amount of time that people are spending on that platform, which is their ultimate goal, right? They want to keep you on that platform as long as possible. And video does a great job of that. So you can share videos, but it's, for me, one of the true advantages of Facebook is the conversation piece, is really having that dialogue with your audience. It seems to be a little bit more robust than on Instagram from my experience. And so you can glean a lot of information about the problems that your audience is facing, about the challenges that they're going through, about the goals they're trying to hit, and the changes they're trying to make in their life, which can be huge, you know, a boon to you in your marketing copy, you know, and just understanding who you're going after. So from that standpoint, it is a tremendous opportunity. And I like that you touched on the groups as well. That is a something that can be extremely powerful. So if you're, you know, say if you have clients that you, you know, for example, we have a dog, we work with a dog training company, and they have specific groups based on what level of training that you've reached. And so if you were basic obedience training, then you have a group that you can go to, and there's people that are in that same, you know, going through those same experiences as you are, and you can find support that way. It's a great way for a business to provide additional value and support without really having to be there every second of the day, because you'll get a lot of your other users to chime in for you, which is even better, right? I mean, they become advocates for your business, and they're teaching other people, and it, as a result, they learn more. And so groups can be a very, very powerful tool. You can use for existing clients, you can use for, you know, you've seen those 5-day challenges that are, you know, the 5-day, you know, grow your business challenge, or 5-day referral challenge, or 5-day build an email list challenge, whatever. And those will often be done in a Facebook group, you know, and so you have a little bit more control over what you can post and who sees those posts, you know, than if you were to just post it out into, you know, on your page. And like you were talking about before with the AI or the algorithm, you have better chance of being seen by all those in the group than if you were to just post it on your page. So those are a lot of things we could keep going on and on, but let's dive into YouTube for a sec. Lynn, what do you say? What do you think about YouTube? I've got some opinions on this, but I want to hear you first.
I know YouTube has recently moved itself into the position where it wants to be seen as the longer format social media platform. So if you are looking to get on YouTube, you want to do between 5 and 12 minute videos, like 10 minutes like is the sweet spot. So you want to reserve your short videos for Instagram, things like that, Twitter, but longer format, you definitely want to do on YouTube. Another thing you don't want to do on YouTube, if you're a podcaster, and this is a common mistake a lot of podcasters make, is just to take your interview, your podcast interview, slap a picture on it and stick it on YouTube, because YouTube will actually downgrade your YouTube searchability if you put those types of videos on YouTube, because it's not an actual video. It's just a really long audiogram. So avoid doing that on YouTube if you're a podcaster, because you don't want to hurt your YouTube SEO. But YouTube is an amazing, it's like, I think it's like the second biggest search engine on the internet. And it's great because when you put a question in, a lot of times you'll see videos pop up on Google. And one of the things I always recommend to my clients is if you're making YouTube videos, embed them in your blog post or embed those YouTube videos in your website, because if somebody clicks on it to see that video, it'll go right to your website or right to your blog, which is incredible for your SEO, because then people are watching the video on your website instead of watching it on YouTube. And you always want to put a good description in each YouTube video so that it's searchable, and you can schedule your videos. So you can do what I call like video stacking, where what I'll do is I'll just make like 8 or 10 videos, and then, you know, get them formatted with my front and back part of my video and all that good stuff, edit it, and then schedule them out so that I don't have to sit there every week and go on YouTube and post it. I can easily and efficiently schedule it out like right from my YouTube channel, which is really great. And you do have to have a Google account to have a YouTube account, because Google and YouTube are the same company. So you need a Google account, and then you can create your own YouTube channel from your Google account, which will feature whatever videos you want to put on there. You can organize them in the playlist. I think YouTube is really, especially if you're in the construction industry or any industry where it's like a how-to, YouTube is a no-brainer. Like, that's one platform you need to be on for sure.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. There's a, you know, there's a lot of unique aspects about YouTube, but I'm just going to touch on a few. I love that you mentioned it's a long form kind of social media platform, and so long form content. And I think what's unique about that, and you can do this, I'm not saying you can't do that on Facebook, or you can't do that on Instagram, but it just makes it easier, you know, where people will go to YouTube and they will, like you were saying with the reels, I mean, you can just get lost for hours and not resurface until it's too late at night. But That's also the unique opportunity that you provide, is if you can produce that type of content that's compelling, that answers questions for your audience. Could be a how-to video. It could be, you know, things that they didn't know that they don't know, you know, just because they're new to whatever it is that you do, new to dog training, for example. Here are three things that you need to know, need to be aware of before you begin obedience training with your dog, you know, or how old does a puppy need to be in order for it to be trained? I mean, there's so many questions that your audience has already, you know, and YouTube can be a great way to answer those questions. And at the same time, build that relationship with your audience, because it's as close as face-to-face as you can get, besides Zoom, I guess. Because they're seeing your body language, you know, they're seeing your intonation, you're hearing that, and they're seeing how you respond and how you, I mean, it's just, there's so much more involvement in your senses, engagement in your senses than just reading it or seeing as a static image. So it provides a very unique opportunity to connect on a much deeper level. And, but also you can use, even if you don't decide to be on YouTube, you can use YouTube to research your audience and what their behavior is like. And you can do this on the other platforms, but I find YouTube is especially helpful, YouTube and Google for this, but you can ask questions that they have, and it's going to lead you to similar videos that are close, but they're not quite the same. And it's going to just add to your understanding of your audience. You know, and you, like I mentioned, Google does that quite a bit. So if you type in a question into Google, you'll get some answers. And then down a little bit down on the page, you're going to see similar questions that people have asked. And as you tap on some of those, then even more questions will come up, and you can get so much information so quickly. There's really no reason you shouldn't have a great understanding of your audience, because all that information is right there. But that's one of the things that I love about YouTube as well, is that you can go into that and answer those questions, find out more about your audience. But really, when it comes down to it, for me, YouTube is a phenomenal opportunity to build that relationship with your audience. So
yeah, because we all know the famous little cute name that was given to YouTube University, because if you need to learn anything, YouTube is actually pretty good for doing that as well. So you can go on YouTube University and find out anything. Like we're looking at building a treehouse, and then we found like all these exotic treehouses you can build in your home. And I'm like, this is so cool. So YouTube University is great for that. And no matter what platform you decide to really interact with the most, one of the most important things we know, Mark, is to be consistent with your posting. So if you want to post 3 days a week, post Thursday, Friday, Saturday, do that, but make sure you're consistent, because consistent posting, like putting a video every week on YouTube, or even if it's every other week, that's still fine. It's still consistent. When you do that consistent posting, that really ups your SEO, and the algorithms on the different platforms will notice you're posting consistently and will show your content to more people more frequently. So consistent posting is really important. What else is really important? We're talking about social media.
Well, and we've touched on this a little bit throughout this, is just connecting with your audience. You know, use it as a way to extend that conversation beyond, you know, beyond the office, or beyond the store, the storefront, the physical brick and mortar store, or beyond the website. You know, I mean, continue that conversation, extrude it out so that you can better understand, you know, I feel like I keep hitting on this, but better understand what they're going through. You know, as you do that, they're going to see you as a much more valuable service provider, you know, because they understand that you know what they're going through. They feel like, oh, this person gets me, you know, and your trust is just going to ratchet up because of that, you know. So that's one of the things, is just dive into that and make sure you're spending time responding to those comments. I see some people that are posting content and the content's good and it's generating engagement, but then they drop the ball. They're not going back in and interacting beyond that. You know, they see comments and like, oh, that's cool, but then they just leave it at that. They don't extend that even further with maybe a follow-up question or a clarifying question, or even just an acknowledgement. You know, because when your audience sees that, then they're more likely to do that in the future. But if you don't, if you're silent, I'm like, oh, okay, maybe they don't care. That's okay. I won't do anything next time. And all that engagement adds up to greater visibility on social platforms. So those are one things that I would say. Is there anything else you'd add to that, Lynn?
Yeah. One other thing I get a lot from people is they ask me like, which platform should they be on? And I feel like you can be on more than one platform as far as posting, but you should definitely choose one or two platforms that really are work with your vertical. So for instance, I have a travel gluten-free podcast. So the platform I'm always on interacting people is Instagram because there's so much travel on Instagram. So you want to really heavily interact on one or two platforms, but you don't have to interact on every platform. Like I post on Twitter, but I don't really interact there a lot because I know most of my avatar, my people, my followers, tribe, community is going to be on Instagram for that specific vertical. So really figure out which one of the social media platforms that are going to be have the most followers on, and definitely engage with that platform the most for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's great. You guys. Well, yeah. Any last words before we conclude this awesome episode?
No, I'm just, if you guys have any questions, definitely hit up Mark or I. Our links are in the description or the show notes below if you're listening to this on the podcast, and we love to hear from you. So Mark, what is in our next episode? What are we coming up with for episode 7?
This one I'm really pumped for because we were touching on it at the beginning of this episode, but we're going to be diving into email marketing. Specifically, is it still viable or is it in fact dead? You know, there's a lot of people that feel like, nobody reads emails anymore. But so we're going to really go deep with that and understand why email is so critical to your overall marketing strategy.
We're so glad you joined us on today's episode.
Tune in each week for a new digital marketing hot seat question from a small business owner just like you.
And if you're interested in being a guest on our podcast, go to digitalmarketinghotseat.com and fill out our interview form.
And remember, make sure to like and subscribe to the Digital Marketing Hot Seat podcast on your favorite podcast player.